My swimming race. Okay, I was, you know, it was a special version of the freestyle, which I had developed over the summer. I touched the water in front of me with my fingertips and swung my arms straight through like a paddle wheel. That summer, I swam over 50 miles in my home team swimming pool. Must have been a mild swimming pool. The standard technique in the freestyle is to stretch your arms in front of you, pull your hand towards you a bit, and then push hard on the backswing. But my technique had a little quirk in it. It was really the only serious competition I was ever in. And that was at the team's home pool. At the last minute, they explained to me I was up against dun-dun-dun-dun, the area champion. You know, that made me feel... I was always nervous at these things. You know, it was a sprint. We would dive in, do a flip turn on the other side of the pool, and then sprint back. Standing on the edge, waiting for the starting gun, I entered into a... You never know. I entered into a very strange mindset. I can't really explain it. It has never happened again, at least not yet. After completing the flip turn, I bumped my arm against the edge of the pool, knowing that may have cost me the race. Yeah, they had me on the edge of the pool, you know. Knowing that may have cost me the race, that mindset kicked in. And I really poured it on. When I touched the other edge of the pool, I noticed the area champion was a couple of lanes down, looking at me in a very peculiar manner. Then I realized I had won the race.
What? How?
Later, the coach, the only one with enough presence of mind not to enter into a state of denial, explained to me what happened. Halfway through the last lap, my body left the water, rising to the surface, and I was literally swimming on top of the water. I was literally swimming on top of the water. I said, you know, you ever seen these kids playing on this piece of plastic, sheet of plastic you put out, you spray it down with a lawn hose, and the thin layer of water on the plastic acts like the perfect lubricant, and you could slide, or, you know, they used to have these things called boogie boards. They were round disc. You threw them in on the wash where the surf washes up on the sand, and you can go skim along real fast. And so I had pulled out of the water, kind of this sort of like a hydroplane type thing. Yep. And you know, people were criticizing this type because they said, oh, that is the wrong way to swim. Well, that's how the coach and I were working on this thing. The paddle wheel technique, apparently, if you do it right, with a certain phase of training, with a certain amount of musculature, gets so this part actually pulls your body up. And if you're going at a certain momentum, you can leave the water and swim on top of the water. Now you're talking. Now we're talking about doing something where you're pew, phew. It's like, that would be something like 17 to 27 miles an hour on the top of the water. Phew. You know, you just have to have a certain mindset for those arms. where you don't have them go, you go like that. But you can do it when you're on the top of the water. See? Well, 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 how about that? I guess I must have picked up that technique from the time I swam away from the man-eating shark. But that's another story. Yeah, something. You see that fin about, this huge fin coming out, just cruising next to you at about, like 12 feet away from you. Da, 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 da. Here comes the danger music, you know. I'll tell you, when you go to the beach, do not let the dog step anywhere near the water. It turns out to be a shark's favorite flavor. Right. Check you later, alligator.
Ah, you're kidding me!
The primary cause of hunger. Agriculture. I repeat. The primary cause of hunger. Agriculture. I used to spend time as much as I could when growing up in nature. After a while, something began to kick in. Something they thought humans didn't have. Instinct. Humankind has domesticated itself. It has bred itself out of instinct. The interactivity of instinct, reason and direction beyond the organism. When left to their own devices, humankind cleared the arable surface and put in monocultural disasters of inefficient plants. Okay, so the concept of agriculture was a big step in the advent of civilization. Yeah, whatever. Whatever. But in the last century, it dead-ended itself in misconceptions of agricultural perfectionism. If the human instincts were still in place, humankind would find out how to assume its real role in the scheme of things and come up with a new facet of food production that would leave agriculture in the dust. Agriculture? Eat my dust. But no, poor, stupid, idiotic mankind has to keep on dead-ending itself into these little pride trips that run their little ships of progress aground. First they go around the island, then they go aground on desert islands. Well, they had the lunch, now they have to have something for dessert. Yep. Poor, stupid, little, idiotic mankind. The pride trip that runs their little ships of progress aground on desert islands and not a fried egg in sight. Not even a fried egg in sight. I mean, we've had the concept of ecology since when? The 60s? What's wrong with you guys? No inspiration? And now you've taken the concept of agriculture into, okay, a facet of big business. And we know what kind of a one-way street disaster that's going to be. Also, now we have the prospect of some groups of stupid morons actually trying to control the food supply. You know, we haven't begun to tap into the resources of all the things that are edible on the planet Earth. Also, a lot of these things, you know, operate in tandem to help control the problem of so-called pests. But let's be realistic here, it's probably not doable in this kind of world. But we have bigger problems now, because such a large portion of the population is outside of the loop of food production, and therefore they are literally at one another's throats, so to speak, in this sort of cutthroat business world that treat each other's businesses as if they were the enemy. Oh my God, I don't believe this crap. This is a recipe for disaster, as in enemy moment now. There is a principle of economics here that entails an observable reality that you might not be privy to, but was very apparent back in the 50s. The economic success of the agrarian society. I wish you could check it out, if it were still possible. Maybe it is. This principle describes the extreme prosperity obtainable when at least 40% of the population of any location is involved in the process of agriculture or agricultural endeavors, or in Australianese, little aggie. Well, I don't know. Maybe that's not... They got aggie in Australian lingo. I don't know. Anyway, little aggie. It has an E in the end. What you're supposed to have in this scenario are clusters of family farmers linked by country roadways with farmer markets situated at places where said roadways intersect. Such farms could receive subsidies by their representative governments, since they really aren't involved in export, but rather are involved in the internal prosperity of any particular nation. I can't reiterate this enough. You need to investigate and establish this if you are to attain true prosperity. But some of you out there know what I'm talking about. And you don't want that, do you? No. You want the situation to end in failure. That's how you get rich, isn't it? That's how you get rich. That's how you get the big bucks. Your false doctrine is that you must succeed at everyone else's expense. Behind you is a wake of failed states and disintegrating nations that you got rich off of. Well, I'm not impressed, and neither are billions of other people who have noticed. But needless to say, poor little Aggie is a sick lady in a sick world. And agriculture, after all, is really... agriculture is really the root cause of hunger in the world. Of course, now there is a new problem with a large portion of the population of the planet. Obesity! I don't believe it. It's there. Just look out the window. Look out the door. But that is another topic for another time, where we discuss the cause of obesity. Primarily, something else you're denying, global warming. Yeah. I'm going to get to it. Global warming. the cause of obesity. Well, at least one of them, one of the primary ones. The role of a rectangle. This began in the 40s with the renowned Jeep. I worked as an information specialist in the Army Material Command in the late 60s, and there were many items in the equipment inventory that were right up there in the public eye. One was the loss of life to rolling light utility vehicles known as Jeeps, circa 1968. And by rolling, I mean the operator would make sharp turns at speed and literally roll the vehicle. It was one of my busiest topics, right up there with nerve gas and disposal of nuclear waste. The modern vehicle, also called Jeep, seems to have corrected the problem, though the original Army model was never intended to be back then driven quickly around tight corners. But now, we had a problem back in 04. I haven't been on top of this lately. I wouldn't put it past the people involved to have, swept it under the rug. But then maybe they didn't. Maybe they cleared it up. I just haven't been following the news. But back in 04, when I wrote this article, there was a lot of SUVs that would roll on the highway. A lot of death and injury involved with this. And, the attitude was, oh, well, and then people began to get on their case. Was it an unsafe vehicle or what? Okay. Those type of contemporary vehicles using the chassis of a pickup truck to comprise the support of a modern sports utility vehicle have neglected the fact, did they do it on purpose, that these vehicles can be driven in excess of 60 miles per hour, and all it takes is a quick swerve and the structure will encounter a phenomenon of geometrical physics, which I call the role of a rectangle. The forward momentum of a rectangular volume will render the longest aspect of its shape into a square wheel. If a veer from its vector introduces enough forward momentum to its side, the advantage, how do you like my sign language? This one is stop. Okay. The advantage of the Jeeps circa mid-60s was its narrow wheelbase. That was the advantage. That assured the vehicle passage in narrow places when encountered, narrow places often encountered, finally got it right, by off-road terrain. Or even getting around congested convoys of larger vehicles on paved or unpaved roadways. However, the operator had to know and be trained how to turn at 90 degrees with that vehicle. A right angle turn with narrow wheelbases must be attempted only after a deceleration to less than 15 miles per hour. The mistake was, only the facts, ma'am. Or it's not over till the fact lady sings. No, that was Tallulah. And good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are. That's no banana, that's a banana republic. Yeah, when the bottom liners, you know. Oh, it must be the bottom line is the main thing here. Oh, the street dictates our bottom line. You know, the bottom feeders, the you know, junk food down there in the sludge of the morass. And it was back in the early part of the 21st century here, the bottom liners flooded the high velocity highway with huge vehicles with off-road type wheelbases. And that was the mistake when they got in the game. I hate to say it, you know. I mean, at this point, it looks like the money isn't in how good your product is, but how good your lawyers are. At least that's how those guys play their game. Look. Got one of those pieces of junk. You can still get around, don't get me wrong. You know, buckle up your family and trust your children in one of those things. Just don't go driving your hustle-mobile as if it were a reliable piece of machinery, and you'll be okay. You know? And Ralph is getting too old to help you anymore. You know, Ralph Nader. Was famous when he managed to rescue us from planned obsolescence back in the 50s, where they were trying to design your car so it would become it would disintegrate after a certain amount of driving. You know, instead of being honest, building something to last. And you know what? I think they're getting away with that now. I'm not quite sure. But, you know, Ralph is not—he's getting too old to help you anymore. He's probably out too busy out running for president, making sure helping the wrong president get into office. Hey, you know, I mean, they thought that North America, the United States, Motor City, man, back in the 50s, they thought, this is where cars are made. Only America can make a car. You know, blah, blah, blah. It's a total illusion. North and South America is the land of the Banana Republic. It's just that in the North, they managed to ban Nana and make it appear to be more legalistic. The banana of the United States, and it's up front exceeding presidentes, was the automobile. That was the big banana. The automobile. By the time the Japanese got around to making an honest car, the Americans had already been there as the fustest with the mostest, and damn, they could still sell those you-know-whaties, even if that one you or someone you know bought for $2.50 a month might be a Canadian make, with parts brought in from everywhere in the globe that could possibly be outsourced. And pretty soon they'll have you assembling them yourself. Just like you have to do when you can't afford real furniture, you have to buy the stuff made of chipboard and assemble it yourself, you know. Ignorance is expensive. What can I tell you? And that's something we all have. You know, so you got to be prepared to pay the price. I drove my anything but Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Them good old boys was drinking Orangtua and Cointreau, saying, this'll be the day that I diet. They were too chubby anyway. Yeah, I was at Aldemont today. The music died. But I saw the comet in the sky and got the heck out of there before Jumpin' Jack ever got on stage. It reminds me of ancient Rome, always emulating the Greeks. Hey, nothing wrong with the Greeks. It's just there is something wrong with lack of originality. That was Rome, always emulating the Greeks. No originality. Back in the 50s, New Rome, the USA, with their Motor City, were making the impression that the automobile was as American as apple pie. Apple pie. I mean, they had apple pie in France. It's just a different name. I forgot what it was. Anyway, they had cars in Europe before Ford ever went to work for Edison. That's right, he worked for Edison for a while. Or even before Ford ever left the farm. There was gasoline in Poland long before there was a rich Rockefeller. But, you see, that's the trouble with the imitators. They can only perfect. They cannot innovate. It's an indictment against the design capability of the big boys. You see, with those guys, they'll do anything to turn a profit. Well, am I wrong? How come they got away with it for so long? Oh, maybe you think it was an honest mistake. Whatever. I had to ride in one of those bounce buses once, and I told jokes, because I knew I was taking my laugh in my hands. Now, okay, here is a probable approach to the geometry dilemma. Abandon the rectangle to compensate for the veer factor. The ideal is the U, but the practical is the spreading of a Y shape with a fork facing forward velocity. But, of course, remember, that's in concept only. That's in concept only. I can't afford to test it for free. You've got to perfect the design before you go and build one, let alone try to manufacture it. The first one to make a safe SUV out there gets rich enough to buy General Motors and Ford. Notice I said rich enough, not smart enough. They probably try to buy Mercedes instead. Number two would probably be smart enough not even to waste their time. And that's the story of the roll of the rectangle. Desolation Row. Desolation Row. Right now, I can't read too good. Don't send me no more letters, no. Not unless you mail them from Desolation Row. And that was by Bob Dylan, a little paragraph of his poetry. Real genuine beatnik stuff there. And, you know, it caught on. Of course, it was legitimate. Believe it or not. I can remember when the beatnik era was going back in the 50s, Bob Hope doing sketches of, you know, like comedy routines of a beatnik trying to be an artist and poet, and they had this huge espresso machine in their apartment, and every 2 seconds it said, you know, oh, man, how about some more espresso? Yeah! No, I got one in the corner over here too. Look who's talking. But I can remember, you know, I was like a kid growing up. My family was in the mid-middle class of then United States, good old U.S. of the A. And, it seemed like we were on a roll, you know. And I remember I was somewhere 6 years old or something, and I had a very uncomfortable feeling about even the name Beatnik, you know. It jarred you. And then later in the 60s, Dylan emerged. He's, mentored by Woodrow Wilson Guthrie, Woody Guthrie, and the quintessential Beatnik. You know what? I do need an espresso. I could use an espresso right now. Vitamin X. Allen Ginsberg, you know, probably before Al decided to take off and hang out with the Aborigines for a while. I remember for a while I was, sleeping on the floor of somebody let me stay in their place, right next door to Al Ginsberg. I never got to meet him though. He was always. Hey, who knows? Anyway, right now I can't read too good. Don't send me no more letters, no, not unless you mail them from Desolation Row. It was Bob Dylan. Zimmy. Robert Zimmerman. Actually, Beatnik, quintessential Beatnik poet. You know, kind of friends with John Lennon. That kind of thing. It did get somewhere. Anyway, the computer is the extension of the brain that is allowing the already wealthy to gain absolute control over everyone else. I see where I'm going now with this. And leech them of every bit of economic substance and kill a large number of them by rendering them homeless. There are no longer any desolation rows, as in Bob Dylan's era of the late 60s. I know, because he was my neighbor down there. You know, in the West Village of New York City, there, Manhattan. So there are no longer any desolation rows that I could tell, you know, unless you have to get outside of the zoning, and that zoning of the urban zoning is like this great blob that just devours everything, spreads, but. The real hip dudes are able to, and the artists are able to get ahead, one step ahead of that, in the beyond the zoning. So they're really, but as far as I can tell from my limited frame of reference here, there are no longer any desolation rows as in Bob Dylan's era of the late 60s. Now almost gone are the hobo jungles, the tent cities, the cardboard hovels. Now, all that remains, perhaps even for you, old reader, is nothing more than a cold, wet curb, an anonymous death, a pauper's unmarked grave, or a waste disposal plant in a Soylent factory somewhere. You know, some of you guys remember the classic film from the 1970s, the movie Soylent Green. What will happen to him, Detective Thorne? Well, he'll be taken outside of the city to a waste disposal plant somewhere. Well, back, I could remember when I was a little girl, they had a ceremony. That was then, Cheryl. That was a long time ago. Da-da, da-da, you know. The scoops have arrived! Scoop the people up, get rid of them. Okay, so, okay, you know, they're probably not even the hobo jungles. I mean, there was a hobo jungle out there when I was in San Jose, California, there along the river, well outside of town. They had picked up from Giuliani's concept of, the 9/11 hero of making the homeless illegal, as far as I could tell. And but they had turned a blind eye to this place. I forgot what the place was called. It was out past the San Jose airport. And it's a huge amount of people living there for free in a kind of a hobo jungle there. But anyway, to get back to this, they have convinced the politically gullible to eradicate governmental supervision and enforcement, and now what remains is an anarchy of the wealthy, where they cook the books and nobody knows. They torture their opponents and nobody sees. They lobotomize the masses and nobody realizes, because they downsized the cops, by and large. That's what it is. And by cops, I don't mean the thin blue line that stands between you and the global riot. I mean the governmental cops put in place by the duly elected officials to ensure the domestic tranquility, and so on and so forth. When you bought that line, they slipped you about how they wanted less government. And that these business guys could take care of themselves. Man, did they pull the wool over your eyes. What the heck is wrong with you people? This didn't happen back in the 1700s, when the founding fathers were really on the ball and wouldn't let anybody hustle them. Perhaps this is the pattern of history. This is history repeating itself. Well, whatever it is, we're all in for a rough ride. And it didn't have to be this way. You know, it didn't have to be this way, buddy. You know? But you know, if you look in the history books, you'll see that these periods of upheaval happen. And maybe even some of the people at work on the situation today, trying to hustle everyone else, have even studied a bit of history. Enough to know certain patterns they can emulate. But you don't care, do you? As long as you get your big old SUV and the luxurious house in peace and quiet on the right side of the tracks. My guess is that the majority is not dead as a doornail, as they seem, but perhaps indebted as a doornail. Aha, I knew it. No culture. They claim they have the so-called pop culture. But pop culture really and actually means no culture at all. When you have culture, there is an abundance of, well, or at least some intellectual stimulation. In contemporary United States of America, there's nothing at all, no culture at all, not even Boy George and his culture club. Now, here's the thing with culture. At first, it's something a person might not want to do, but after a while, really gets into it and enjoys it. And the result is intellectual stimulation to the extent where the person becomes an operable, integral, functioning part of not only society, but also successful endeavors of renowned achievements. There. That sort of puts it in a nutshell for you. Only what we have in this contemporary society, and not just the United States, this is happening elsewhere in the globe, in developed nations. What you've got here is a real nutcase in the person of every walking around individual out there, instead of a nutshell description of uplifting and intellectual stimulation. Back in the Bohemian days, the Beatnik days, there was this sort of Desolation Row where at least you could go ahead and live there and pursue an intellectual life of poetry or artwork or music or something enriching. This started way back in the days of the Bohemian kings around the Czech region of old Europe and went as far as the Beatnik era of the famous Beatnik poets such as Allen Ginsberg and so on, who eventually, in my opinion, confronted their dead-end streets of drug abuse, you know? I mean, if you imagine Allen Ginsberg without the drugs, because he ended up a basket case in some compassionate Buddhist monastery somewhere in upstate New York with a box of meds as big as both your arms almost, and, you know, died, ignominiously, somebody having to just carry him around. You know, imagine a Ginsberg who didn't do drugs, and like went on the natural high instead. That's what I advocate. Okay. But anyway, I digress. I know the type of Desolation Row Ginsberg lived in. So I once stayed in an apartment next door back in the 70s. But eventually, he ended up in that Buddhist monastery. But now, there's no more of that. No more cheap slum housing. At least not the type that you could use for anything, unless you're in some kind of derelict city such as, let's face it, they might still get away with it in Newark, New Jersey, you know, part of the ancient megalopolis of old-time America. No. But with computerization, it enables the merchant-minded to ferret their way into every nook and cranny, wringing the life out of every possible walking around person that they can transform even involuntarily into that mindless consumer that they so dearly desire for their burgeoning ranks of impulse buyers, with no longer any governmental oversight to even so much as blow a whistle. You know, there's not even a Desolation Row anymore. There is not even a Desolation Row. They went ahead and developed it. Now it's, what do they call it? luxury lofts. You look up there, you won't see AIR hanging out of any window. Artisan residence. Okay, there's not even a Desolation Row anymore. Anybody think anyone would ever want to bemoan the trans juxtaposition of all Desolation Rows, you know? Did you ever imagine that somebody would like miss the disappearance of Desolation Row? It's happening. That's right. Well, it's come to that. They're not even selling postcards of the hanging. They're not even painting the passports brown. And forget that sailor bit. They were the first to go down. No more circus in town. Oh, you can get out there. You can live in the slum, but it's going to be even worse than ever, because all you've got there anymore are the drunks and the drugged who have sunk all their paychecks into their super sound systems, triumphantly blasting every neighbor on the block away with the voodoo drums of their favorite machete hacking genocide music, which they need to mask the sense of guilt they feel over their criminal lifestyles, evaporating every possible inspiration you could have ever gotten for poetry, music, or art. Hey, who knows? Maybe there's something out in Calcutta. Or maybe out there way up in Tibet. Yeah, maybe Tibet. Early Tibet. Garage 'em off. Garage 'em off. Okay, they once had a very short lived premiere of the Soviet Union. I think it was just before Gorbachev got in. His name was Garajimov. Garajimov. So I have this sort of play on words here. Garajimov. Okay. The American garage inventor outfoxed the big guys and changed the course of history, as it was destined to be in the first place. I lived in a garage for a while. It's one of the things I did. Part of that clubhouse, that outfit. I stapled a large sheet of transparent plastic to one of the walls. Oops, sorry for the sound. To one of the walls, and used a small ceramic heater inside, creating a little heated bubble like a small stationary hot air balloon. It really works. I called it the cocoon, and I wrote a book there. But it reminds me of what some people can do when they don't worry about materialism. How does the cliche go? Try as you may. Try as you may, but that's a different slant on that cliche, huh? It was slanty. It must have been a lean on the house. Well, well, well. Try as you may. Looks like there is some sort of battle between good and evil, after all, out there. A battle between the functionality of life itself versus the drive of subverted intelligence to produce a hermetic existence, or should I say an hermetic existence. And let me assure you that this quote-unquote garage, this garage inventor thing, that's not indigenous to the 20th century America either. Since day one, there's been this kind of lunatic effort to exercise control over human beings, human nature, etc., etc., and on they go. Try to control it. Try to control it. It'll go wild. It will go wild. Try to put a lid on it. It'll explode. As in, every lid bit helps, I'm sure. It will take off even better in contemporary 21st century China, or in the back streets of New Delhi. I know you'll never believe me, but you could just keep from wasting an awful lot of time if you're trying to control humanity. It doesn't work. Somebody in the back lot somewhere, somebody in a garage, some Goddard out in a field with a couple of enthusiasts developing rockets, some Pierre and Marie Curie working in a little lab, some Socrates out there teaching a bunch of teenagers for free, whatever. I mean, it goes on. I'll tell you about some of these quote-unquote evil guys going around with their perpetual Halloween costumes, wearing their religion on their sleeves, or whatever they're trying to do. I mean, sometimes they're obvious, sometimes they're not. They're not very competent, you know. They go back to the gambit of history. They have a profile. They are notorious for trying to exert control. They think they belong to the ultimate tough guy clubhouse, and each one of them imagines himself to be the ultimate bad boy. The ultimate bad boy. Well, they all get old. They all fade. Eventually, their activities wear off. And then, out of nowhere, out come the little garage-moths and produce some kind of little gadget that liberates mankind, rescues the universe, or whatever it is. It will always happen, whether you like it or not. And I'm sure you don't. Get over it! Now, it's curious here, as we observe our little scene of two prize fighters in a boxing ring coming out of their corners slugging away. When you study the situation, you've got to realize there is no coexistence in this scenario. Having gotten that far, that will help you to size up your own situation in this ongoing scenario on how you're going to deal with this sort of thing. I mean, this is it. That is existence in a nutshell. That is Henry Ford driving out of his garage for the first time. Instead of Wolfgang Schmidt or Harold Plushbottom or Henri Fondu or Tubal Otobubada or Vladimir Vlaskomovich or the man in the moon. Gee, I'm having trouble pronouncing even my mock-up names. Yes, try as you may. And believe me, in my lengthy travels, I have seen quite an appreciable effort on the part of the controllers, running around all over the place, frantic, leash in hand, trying to snap it on 50,000 new collars that emerge daily. An exercise in futility. Well, have at it, boys. You embarrass me. But I know you don't care about that. You're too busy trying to be important. So go ahead. Be that way. I hope you hear this. It may save you some effort, and it may help a couple of million of you to keep from going insane. It's just that every time I hear some of your stooges use the term bad guys, it makes me cringe. What if some of those people out there actually believed you? I mean, sometimes if you don't watch it, you guys could really get away with something big, like burying all the intellectuals alive the way Emperor Qin of ancient China did. They took them all, rounded up, and buried them alive. I wonder how many there were back then. There's not as many people in the world then. Ah, I get it. Now that the microchip is getting smaller and smaller, some of you guys out there are actually going to try to go on a massive implant campaign. A campaign in the what next? In a massive state. Yeah, state effort. A massive state effort. That's the thing you control the most. Funky imitation politics. In a massive state effort to monitor every human being on the face of the earth. Get ready for this. They're already thinking about putting it like, oh, tin can at my feet. Think I'll kick it down the street. That's the way to treat a friend. Oh, wait a minute. This is a 21st century tin can. I'll go ahead and photograph him instead. That's the way to photograph a friend. Where's the camera on this thing? Junk cameras, you know? Oh, cardboard box here. Throw it away. No, wait a minute. We can use the junk camera for a while. We've got to upload to YouTube. You believe it? Yeah, well, if that ever happens, I could speculate that that's the point where you start to make close encounters of the third type. Yeah. And they kick your little beastly backsides in a war of the worlds that viruses do not decide the outcome of. Remember the last time the War of the Worlds, H.G. Wells, the Martians died of the common cold. Well, this is going to be a case where the control freaks die of a kamikaze cold war. To paraphrase an old song, when virus eyes are smiling. Or to put it another way, try as you may. No denudes is good denudes. Yep, you know, in the forest existent, forest plural. The forests existent in much of New England, such as Vermont and New Hampshire, are by and large new growth. In the early times of about the mid-20th century, vast swatches of the New England landscapes were virtually denuded. hence the term, no denudes is good denudes. In the colonial days, New England served also as the quote-unquote China and the quote-unquote Vietnam. This is getting to be that China is going to start outsourcing to Vietnam or somewhere else. Now, they already have, actually. Of the textile industry, where old England outsourced its labor of textile work to the colonial mills along the New England riverways, denuding the landscape of forests is treason, as trees in the ground, trees in. It's a joke. Yuck, yuck, yuck. The forest systems, well, the funniest joke is to tell the truth, right? The forest systems are the only effective way to sequester carbon dioxide. That's the only effective way to do it. It's done naturally, and the oxygen is returned to the atmosphere. But there is a balance. The mini ice age of the mid-19th century may have been the result of not only excessive volcanic activity, but also perhaps an overbalance of forest natural growth. Now, you know what we're talking about here is, I think I go into it a little later, but some scientists were really starting to get on the ball here, and they found out that trees, and let's see, where was this? Cambridge. Because in Cambridge, there is a piece of ground that has the original old-growth forest of the North America in the pre-colonial era. And they found out from there, they were able to find out doing the studies and the controls that what happens is the trees, you know, they thought, well, trees are like a carbon pump, but they don't really store carbon like that. How would they do that? And, you know, scientifically, they were kind of right. Well, how did trees play into this? They found out that actually from this study in Cambridge, we're using these ancient trees to study that and the soil around it. They measured the soil. They found what happens is the trees take the carbon dioxide and they store it in the soil. Okay. And they acquire it whenever they have the possibility to do photosynthesis, which doesn't happen all the time. It's not going to happen in winter. It's not going to happen when the sun ain't shining. It's not going to happen at night. You have to have the sun shining on the leaves for this photosynthesis process. The carbon dioxide is acquired from the soil. Now, as far as I know, didn't have time to really study that in that detail. And then the carbon is kept as sugars and food, and the oxygen is returned to the atmosphere. So it is the only effective way to sequester carbon dioxide. Oh, I don't see the government giving these huge grants to industry or industry going out there saying, well, how can we do this then? Plant the trees. You know, forests are always too thick. Usually, almost always too thick. And mankind has large equipment, huge equipment. Now, you can use huge equipment to remove a fully grown tree from its aspect in the old forest and replant it in a whole different area successfully. So, in other words, if you were to take the existing forest and spread it out, immediately that would begin to accomplish this problem. Now, when you spread out a forest, you have to remember, you just don't have the tree standing alone. A tree standing alone is vulnerable to wind. You didn't know that, huh? You have to have the scrub growth. The scrub growth creates a vegetation wedge that buffers the tree against the oncoming wind. So there's some basic things there. I mean, look, once you stop worrying about your daggum bottom line and all that, I hate to regurgitate this for you all the time, but I mean, if you get sick enough about it, your barf will be worse than your bite. And you'll be able to probably think of this stuff for a change, and somebody out there will be able to do something. You want to plant trees, feed squirrels nuts. They'll plant them, and they'll only eat a small amount of them. And they can plant them in your neighbor's backyard where you cannot dare to go. Okay, so this natural sequestering of carbon dioxide is done naturally, and the oxygen returned to the atmosphere. There is a balance. We talked about the mini ice age. Remember that? The mini ice age that happened? Okay. There was a time where it began to, around the time of, which one, who was it? Peter Bruegel, the Bruegel brothers. They used to do these landscape paintings of hunters going out in deep snow, and other people doing paintings, Dutch masters doing paintings of the people ice skating on waterways that normally wouldn't freeze over that much. It was a mini ice age there in Europe. And now I'd like to do a little bit of more study on that somehow. If I could get the grant for it, that'd be interesting, to determine that it may be that they acquired the ability to use coal for heat and stopped felling trees for heating, and they stopped using wood, and they started using coal, and you had a resurgence of tree growth, and as soon as the main resurgent recovered, it started a new mini ice age when the trees were doing their proper functionality that actually brought the temperature, the global temperature, down. Of course, there may have been a huge advent of volcanic activity as well. So anyway, enter a new era for the poor old forestry industry. The carpentry industries, cottage and large, and those actually who use hardwood for fuel. Can you believe that? They also have an ecological niche in releasing carbon dioxide into the food chain. The Pacific Silhouette. That sounds like a strange title, doesn't it? Mexico and Canada are poised to eclipse the United States, who never saw the Mexican potential. Now the greatest economic partnership of all time is poised to leave the clumsy giant behind in the dust. They will not have to further relations with a spoiled loose association of the lower 48 United States. The National Association of the District of Columbia, or have to deal with its conceit, complexes of denial, and just plain ineptitude. The U.S. will be so concerned with sticking a finger in the burgeoning dike of nuke proliferation that they will have missed the last boat to the new rising star in the world, the American Economic Union, the AEU. Heck, maybe even Alaska will opt out and become the AEU nation of, I don't know, how about Ilusha? I mean, you got to go where the money is, don't you? Now you see what happened is, now I have to check up on this again, but I began to see the pattern here. What happened is Mexico was just passing the United States by, and they were actually eclipsing the United States and shipping directly from Mexico to Canada, just completely skirting the USA. So it was an eclipse of the United States. I said, well, what about that? The Pacific silhouette. And I don't know if that's still going strong, but that was the Pacific run between Mexico and Canada. A link of concourse. And now, you know, that's, of course, there's this big port city of Vancouver. But we'll have to see. To sea. From sea to shining sea. So, strap yourselves in for that one. That ought to be interesting. Music. About time. What? I mean, music about time. Yep, music about time. The principles of music are many, most of them unknown. But among the known is time, tempo, time. As the kids said in the playground, time is on my slide. Yes, it is. The profound composition, recorded or otherwise, would not be bound to one time frame, such as 4/4 or foxtrot or waltz in 3/4 time. It reminds me of the Strauss who decorated his study with waltz paper. Yuck, yuck, yuck. Some of the masters of synthesized music even incorporate sonic time pictures in the music of the composition, such as an adagio of crystal-sounding high notes at millisecond staccato repetitions. And it still comes out as legitimate, if not profound, music. The master of these high-frequency beats are aquatic animals. In fact, rhythm is an essential part of our everyday lives. But those are natural rhythms. Assumed rhythms by human timpanists are almost always, at best, wrong. But at worst, which appears to be the average, it's harmful. One of the standard aspects of natural acoustic rhythm is usually randomization. That's just a start. In order to produce a symphonic work with the correctly randomized natural tympanic complement, much investigation and research has to be done, although it may not have to entail the stringent methods of the scientific lab. I thank God for that. Who can afford a lab? But it certainly might, first of all, mean that the composer has to spend a lot of time in nature carefully noting the sounds. This is what annoys people about my music. It's probably why I get so few views. Even though I don't really use that much timpani except in the strum of the guitar, for example, what annoys strict music buffs and certain musicians is that I instinctively randomize the tempo of the music. Yeah, listen to my stuff, you're going to get randomized tempo. Actually, it's quite nice. You ought to have a listen sometime. I could use the views. Okay. Now, what annoys these guys is that I instinctively randomize the tempo of the music. Having spent as much of my teenage years as I possibly could in nature. Okay, it might be because I'm dyslexic or something else. I don't want to romanticize it or anything, but I really gained something. Anyone could gain by spending time in nature. Among other things, I learned to treasure random sounds like frog peeps or the patter of rainfall and so on. I learned about my randomization when a violinist accompanied me for a few months when I was singing in the Paris metros. For a while, she tried in vain to correct me. She tried in vain to correct what she considered my problem. Others did too. You know, continual contact with the natural world does help to reawaken, to some degree at least, human instinct within the individual. And human instinct can be quite extraordinary, particularly with music. A mockingbird used to visit one of my workplaces, you know. Yeah, I used to have a mockingbird visit me at that workplace every day. Would show up and work with me on the naturalization of a jazz number. He or she really came up with some great riffs. I'm not kidding you. Of course. Do you realize how much more you could say if you sang instead of just talked when you communicated? It would astound all of us. Do you realize how much more you could say if you sang instead of just talked? When you communicated, it would astound all of us. The trepidation of investments. The primary purpose of a business is none other than to secure a livelihood. But I'm sorry, your activities interfere with your human development. You're going to need to be capitalized, and that's just about these days becoming more anti-human than ever. Investment kills livelihood. If it were not so, Wall Street would have been a major player in the success of mass small business in every community. Yeah. It was the investment industry that destroyed the family farm in Iowa in the 80s. It is the investment industry and whatever holds their leash. I got that quote from Star Wars number one. I would expect you to be holding Vader's leash. Okay. Charming to the last. Okay. It is the investment industry, and whatever holds their leash, great line, that not only destroys small business, but also has an interest in doing so. That's how bad it is, buddy. They fear a healthy, educated middle class. Here's how it, or how boosted economic investment works. Citizens enter a voluntary training, if they choose to do so, funded by the investment community. Now, this is what we call boosted economic investment. You gotta watch out for your pronouns. You know, you have to have the precedent and the antecedent. Okay. Citizens enter a voluntary training, if they choose to do so, funded by the investment community. The initial business is aided by the investment community with instruction and support. The community having a vast segment of its auspices vested in the information services. The business is funded, and if it fails, the second and third efforts are also funded. The funding does not include interest, but rather a fee, and in the case of measurable prosperity, a commission for services rendered and a royalty of less than 1% for a given period of time. But you see, the investment community is reduced to narrow-minded, cowardly, sniveling, little pathetic excuses for humanity, who, because of their miserly nature, the miserly nature of their trepidation, have an extorted sum, much less than the largesse they could have enjoyed had they used the practical boosted economic practices. And instead of becoming pillars of a society and a vital ingredient in the prosperity of a nation, they have slumped to the shame of being nothing more than the blood-sucking leeches thereof. Their flag-waving is only for public relations. With plastic on sticks produced by other nations in substandard condition by slave labor because of their incessant pink-slipping and outsourcing, the sunshine patriot has taken the new connotation of the public relations patriots. My ancestors, who had to fight in the Revolutionary War, so these leeches in our time could have enough freedom to extort others, would have been ashamed of them, as I am. Hey, is that a trained dog I see over there jumping through hoops to entertain those rich scallywags? Oh no, it's some poor soul trying to improve his or her credit rating so they can go to trade school and then spend the next 20 years paying them back, I do declare. I put on my spectacles to see the spectacle. Why, it's no American dream. It's an American scheme. It's an American scheme. You think I'm just being opinionated? I'm not even doing the subject justice here. You know that .com thing would have worked and would have brought in prosperity on a global scale never before imagined. It was destroyed by the same gentry that caused the savings and loan debacle, because the common person stood to make too much of an income thereby. A certain ilk has made incredibly, a certain, well, let me rephrase that. They have made incredibly unbelievable moves here, but a certain ilk was made incredibly wealthy by those and other schemes. And they are too scared and incompetent to do anything with those vast sums besides just sit on it like a mama hen in the chicken coop going clucky. Well, this time round, you know what's going to happen to them? They're going to get caught. That's what. How about that, plastic flag? You can run, but you can't hide. Yes, plastic flag, you can run, but you cannot hide. Consider yourself busted. Oh, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. It's just going to happen. It's just going to happen. This is just a warning, a shot across the bow. Who's going to bust the leeches then? Who's going to bust them? Why, the cops, my boys. The cops. That's who. Basic telepathy. Yeah, that's the title. Basic Telepathy. What, Telepathy 101? Sounds too, you know, collegiate there. Basic Telepathy. It's going to take quite some time to develop the ability to use what you already got. It's kind of like the sensation of thoughts, but it isn't you. You parallel one another's thought. The catch is in realizing the difference. Often the original thinkers are hated because unconsciously the sluggish mind find themselves imagining they are thinking difficult and deep thoughts they don't want to think. you ever see these guys sort of like cringe when they're sitting there like in a break room somewhere and somebody's coming in who's actually thinking of something and they start to really cringe even more? They're picking up on it. I began to realize this during rush hours, you know. I realized a lot of the stuff that was going through my mind wasn't even my thinking. It was like, had to be those around me. So, original thinkers are hated because unconsciously the sluggish find themselves imagining they are thinking difficult and deep thoughts that they don't want to think. Be careful before you own that thought. Elements of the criminal mentality may be communicable. The so-called dumb animals to which the human beings attribute incapability of thought may be more intelligent than perceived, and they may be adept at telepathic communication. So look, oh, they're dumb animals. Oh, no, man. They may actually be talking up a storm without having to use vocal cords. Maybe like the human being was endowed with vocal cords because they were so darn stupid they couldn't figure out what was going on, so they were given the compensation of being able to talk. You know? So these dumb animals that they're so called may be actually more intelligent than you think. They may actually be telepathizing, you see? They may actually be adept at telepathic communication, thus eliminating the need for cumbersome physical vocalization attributes. Only a honking horn on occasion, so to speak. You know, observe how they correctly keep away from humans. That the humans' lack of ability to communicate may make said human highly dangerous. Yeah, this is just yesterday. I was out there by the fire escape in the back. Looked over my head, and there was one of these cute little yellow birds there, right there, trying to say something without words. So that's basic telepathy 101. Bottom liners, carpetbaggers, scalawags, book cookers, and bottom liners, all the same ilk. They want a destabilized public subject to impulse buying. Yes, folks, introducing the bottom liner traditionalists, the BLTs, straight out of pork barrelistic reactionaryism, the shallow-minded flotilla of the wealthy are Congress benders from way back. They go back, perceptibly at least, as far as ancient Rome, where they first assailed that Senate, ultimately establishing a puppet legislation under a dictatorial emperor. Because the preoccupation of the bottom line will ultimately induce a mass hysteria, a psychotic reaction causing the bottom liner to grasp at straws, as the vernacular puts it, with the classic what's in it for me knee-jerk reaction of appointing a lifetime presidente, or this time a dictator of global proportions. Yep, the global dictator is not that far off either. Because of the bottom liners. United States governed by minority. The majority of the United States public is apathetic and self-defeating. I have traveled over 50,000 miles in the United States in one summer. I did that, let alone the other parts, other aspects of my travel throughout these contiguous states and in Alaska, in some of the territories, Samoa, Puerto Rico, so on and so forth. I have traveled over 50,000 miles in the United States, and in my contact with the peoples that comprise the majority of the voting populace, I have discovered not only an apathy, but also a disdain for the exercise of all rights afforded them by the Constitution and other auspices of dictums of civic duties in force in the United States. Yeah, actually a disdain. Can you believe it? Hey, you know, I tell you, I call the shots as I see them. I tell you what I have discovered. I was out there. I didn't just sit there from the armchair, you know. Hey, this chair doesn't have arms, you know. So, the average attitude was that such exercises of obligation, such as voting or expression of opinion, such as writing or emailing representatives and so forth, was in the average consensus foolish, and that the average individual I spoke with imagined him or herself above such matters. You see? And it's like, oh, well, why don't you let your congressman know? Why? They look at me, they thought that was foolish. Therefore, it's not out of place to note that their lot in life has no place or eventually will be ignored by the process of government and such programs as public medical concern and old age benefits for the poor will eventually go ignored except for the occasional deference from the legislations and executives elected by the minority of the rich and powerful that can and do vote and also lobby and petition. You know, this is not unique to America, the United States. I found the same to be true in Australia. However, the Australians, at least while I was there, are required to vote. The Australian government required their voters to vote by law. It was against the law not to vote. Pretty smart, huh? Smart bunch of blokes, damn.